Non, non, non. Non, je vais le faire moi. Non, je dis que quelqu'un qui fait quelqu'un. Bon, facile, tout ça marche. Bon, excuse me. Sorry for the weather. Thank you for being come. Because you already, you can see my English is not very good. So for my presentation, I try to transform this personal disability in a kind of experiment. My presentation, there are two parts of this presentation. Were performed and registered before to me at Bucharest at the national radio. There will be such like a broadcasting performed by the voices I have to say it, Eugenia Kira and Kalin Kacoyev from English Service of Romanian Broadcasting Corporation, and the translations of the text are Florin Bican and Andrea Lazar. It will be a sound performance lecture, and in the same time, on the screen, a slideshow presentation, which not reproduces the what we hear, but intersects the text of the lecture with some precisions, some quotations who are not in the main text. I will start both the video and the sound. Thank you. My name, sorry for now presenting. My name is Bogdan Ghiu. It's more, at least in these two texts, I'm more a poet than a philosopher. You will see. Thank you.
Dada democracy.
The Dada intemporal. Zara Spinoza Evans.
Art instead of politics.
What new constitution can replace the old one? When will we grow up and stop frightening ourselves with such boogaboos? The old constitution, invented to keep the prisoners of the cave in captivity, has had ample time to roll out its effects. It is time now to make an effort to imagine a political philosophy for assemblage of human and non-humans. We still do not have the slightest idea what the consequences of such a reunion, such a resumption of the work of collection might be. We simply know that what was formerly prohibited by the split into two houses has now become possible. We now know how to begin again, quite simply, to undertake democratic politics instead and in place of that imperial politics. Bruno Latour, Politics of Nature, How to Bring the Science into Democracy, Harvard University Press, 2004.
Democracy is Dada, an act of constantly triggering off the creativity of randomness, the merging of data. Or else it's a crisis. The truly ecumenical miracle of Christ is regaining humanity regardless of the combinations we resort to. No matter what combination the data of humanity occur in, it is the Son of Man that emerges unfailingly. It is Jesus as the symbol of man that we rediscover time and time again, though each time as new man. Today's church, nonetheless, is the market, and it dramatically curtails all possible combinations, thus cutting into humanity's divine body.
Pour faire un poème dadaïste.
To make a dadaïste poem?
Prenez un journal.
Take a newspaper.
Prenez des ciseaux.
Take some scissors.
Choisissez dans ce journal un article ayant la longueur que vous comptez donner à votre poème.
Choose from this paper an article of the length you want to make your poem.
Découpez l'article.
Cut out the article.
Découpez ensuite avec soin chacun des mots qui forment cet article et mettez-les dans un sac.
Next, carefully cut out each of the words. words that make up this article and put them all in a bag.
Agitez doucement.
Shake gently.
Sortez ensuite chaque coupure l'une après l'autre dans l'ordre où elles ont quitté le sac.
Next, take out each cutting one after the other in the order in which they left the bag.
Copiez consciencieusement.
Copy conscientiously.
Le poème vous ressemblera.
The poem will resemble you.
Et vous voilà, un écrivain original doué d'une sensibilité charmante, encore qu'incomprise du vulgaire.
And there you are, quote unquote, an infinitely original author of charming sensibility, even though unappreciated by the vulgar herd. After having been considered long dead, historicized beyond redemption, historical avant-garde movements are once again enjoying attention, albeit commemoratively, as they are exhumed and celebrated as mere cultural objects, that is to say, in their very capacity as historical dead, as specters, impotent, disarmed, domesticated, harmless. Those curious enough to pursue these studies, both old and recent ones, written and continuing to be written on avant-garde movements, will only be able to discern a limp objectivist historicism. In other words, their purely museum-like reactivation. There is no novel avant-garde idea coming to indwell the letter of the old boisterous manifestos being symbolically unearthed with protective gloves and in sealed environments, like mummies deviantly representative of a modernity and of a hyper-modernism deactivated in their turn under suspicion of being contaminated with a lethal, not yet dormant virus. Dangerous exhibits which no one can rid, not that anyone is thus inclined, of the cautionary label, complete with skull and crossbones, plus mandatory exclamation points. Danger! Do not touch! Handle with care! Museums defend us, keep us away from their exhibits. Due to the sanitary, historicist cultural attitude revealed in exhibiting them, avant-garde movements are regarded, implicitly and preventively, as corpses, and dangerous, possibly contaminated corpses at that.
Of all avant-garde movements, Dada is in the Dada movement, more precisely, was the only one managing to escape ending up in a system. Dada carries the purest, most radical of all avant-garde ideas. Unadulterated gestuality, quick to undergo resumption, anonymously disseminated in what we might call avant-garde movements, proper, institutionalized, that is, which followed it and which itself made possible through a seminal gesture as a threshold surpassed, as a ruptured dam blockage. Dada is the avant-garde of the avant-garde. It is the very idea of avant-garde in its full generality and precariousness. Dada did not become an ideology, nor did it dream of becoming politics. Dada is a sub-impressed historical transcendental of current art. During the brief inaugural moment marking the commencement of the correction intervention, each contemporary artist inevitably and invisibly undergoes a brief Dada amnesis. Dada is the moment zero, minus triggering off contemporary art. The art that renders things contemporary. As Tristantzara himself used to say, Dada is not.
The notion and term avant-garde manifesto, Dada manifesto, are not to be taken as nouns, but, as Heidegger used to say about being, as verbs, as act, not as object. The so-called Dada manifestos, the first, the second, the third, etc., having a simple date and location ascribed to them, are not to be read as objects, as nouns, but as verbs in the indicative, therefore imperative mode, as manifestation and ontological imperative, at the level of being, of the manifestation. This text, this gesture, manifests Dada. Manifest Dada! Manifest yourselves, Dada! An inconsumable gesture, Dada can only be repeated, being itself a repetition.
Da 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 da. Da 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 da. What cannot pass, what is not conceived as an object, but only as a triggering off gesture, can only be repeated.
Something genuinely new can only occur through repetition. What the repetition actually repeats is not the way in which the past, quote-unquote, has been effective, but the inherent virtuality of the past, betrayed by its past virtualization. The new can only occur through repetition. Something genuinely new occurs as an eternity in time, transcending its own material conditions. A genuinely new work of art stays new forevermore. Its newness does not run out, not even when its so-called shock value has dissipated. The work of art is, more often than not, providing the context that allows us to understand, in truth, a given historical situation. Slavoj Žižek, Organs Without Bodies, Deleuze and Consequences, Routledge, 2003.
Dada is the gesture by which art re-triggers itself off, by which art becomes once again, each and every time, open, possibly alive. Dada is a manifestation of life as art, love becoming art directly. For that's what it actually is, impossible to summon, other than through its culturalization, through its transformation into an object of cultural consumption, into a curiosity, into an unengaging weirdness, disarmed, neutralized, sanitized. The Dada negativity is in fact the positive affirmation of life. Negativity alone is affirmative and primal due to its opposition to the primal non-differentiation and homogeneousness. Hominization and aliveness always start through a separation, through a negation, through an act of dislodgement, of uprooting, through a quality leap.
To make a Dadaist poem is part of a Dada manifesto. It is a famous Dada poem revealing the basic, most provocative Dada technique, that of creation available to all by the recourse to chance, to hazard. The poem has an act of casting arts by re-challenging and redescending into chaos.
Art is a form of gambling. Mallarmé.
Un coup de dé jamais n'amollira le hasard.
Nietzsche via Deleuze, trusting in chance, in hazard, staking everything on one card as the only possibility of repetition, of affirming the perpetual return.
Only supreme surprise and irony, what Zara calls in this brief, flashingly precise text, technically a Dadaist poem, turns out to be literature itself is Dada. Dada in its turn is nothing but the ironic manifestation of the generality of literature, art, creation. Dada is not an avant-garde movement. Dada is not. And there is no way it could have ever disappeared. It could only undergo resorption into the generic act of artistic creation.
Sarah is talking here about us, the people of today, thus activating the idea of fashion. Because at that particular moment, immediately after World War I, the great war of capitalism, Dada emerged as a fashion, as a curiosity, manifesting the idea that anyone could be an artist.
The poem is akin to a cooking recipe, to a set of DIY instructions. Irony and earnestness. Dada is a fashion, anyone can be fashionable.
Moreover, and that's an extremely present idea, it's not only personalized, customized, individualized, consumer-oriented products that account for the fashion. It is ourselves that are able and ought to produce what we want to participate, hyper-ironically, in the fashion, not by merely purchasing products as consumers, but by getting involved in their manufacturing as actual manufacturers. Individual knowledge has been disqualified by capitalist production in order to make us dependent, yet we, ironically enough, are ourselves able to produce, manifest ourselves as independent, autonomous beings, however, for the very purpose of participating without any feeling of alienation in the capitalist movement of fashion itself. This is the unheard peal of laughter of the Dada spirit, describing prophetically the current post-industrial moment of capitalist self-critical and self-revolutionary triumph. We are independent and autonomous, yet only to the end of reproducing models.
Dadaism ironically affirmed as fashion. Anyone can be a Dadaist, that is, can participate in the fashion.
In an extreme paradox, Dada puts itself forth under our very eyes as Dadaist, in other words, as a fashionable trend of fashion itself.
Simultaneously, it is against the market, through its liberation from the passive, reified consumer condition, Yet all it does this way is generalize the market. Internalized capitalism.
Its gesture equals done. What are the gestures in this utilitarian auto-literature next? Cut out, shape, make out, copy. Giving free rein, that is, to the random manifestation of substance, to the substance creating randomness.
Everything starts in the newspaper and reverts to the newspaper. How do we get to the paper? Starting from the paper.
How can one become an author of literature? How can one reach, in other words, the pinnacle of market subjectivization and individuation by cutting out, shaking, taking out, copying? Dada is not the negation of literature, but literature, art self-revealed. Dada is a sculpture in a socially pre-existing Dada does not negate literature, but neutralizes it, exposes it in its full mechanical banality, in its full capitalist industrial artificiality. Zara's recipe poem ought to be read from the ulterior perspective of such a text as Michel Foucault's What is an Author?
Though subject to irony as idealization, as subjectivist market illusion, merchandise subjectivity in Marius Babiash's words, literature and art are not negated thus, but, albeit ironically, democratized, set in agreement with themselves as an impersonal personalization technique.
When negated, syntax and grammar in general do not count, since socially the matter, making up technically, procedurally, our subjectivity is semantically performed, materials already are formed, considering that they've been pre-selected, pre-formed.
This is the price of acceding to the privilege of social subjectivity, artificiality, the technical artificiality method.
Things are nevertheless as serious as they can be. We cut out our individuality from what is socially pre-existing. What Zara negates is the art as an idealistic capitalist lie. This is art, is what Dada says. We can all have mechanical, that is instant access to it, orbit on an impersonal basis. Isn't this one of art's current slogans? Immediate raw, ready-made art, the joy of recognized subjectivity, is nothing but an impersonal artifice, a technique for activating the impersonal.
We can only enjoy a fake subjectivity, a technical, manufactured subjectivity. That is the price. Ethically, it is worth knowing that, being aware of it. Subjectivization requires technique, procedures for extricating ourselves from the personal and the generic. Creation is plus through minus, affirmation through extrication and recombination. Negation itself is affirmative. Dada is an ethics that can only as ethics put forth politics.
In order to make ourselves a poem, art, in order to become authors and participate in the ontological capitalist movement of constructing the art society, it is not only the length of the article that counts, as Zara points out, but also its title. Shall we construct our subject poem out of the words of a political, food, fashion article, out of a lampoon, out of a book or exhibition review?
Worth still. Out of what newspapers, out of what media, what ready media could construct today in Dadaist manner our poem, our social subjectivity? Dada becomes an impossible ethics, while Zara's irony becomes acute. It worsens, becomes dramatic. We have accepted the lie of art, which is actually its artificial ontology. We do know that the matter out of which we socially carve our being cannot be virgin, but it is already formed and pre-selected. Still, capitalism has come to preform entirely the prefabricated matter of our being. We have no choice, really. The media, as impersonally representative, socially pre-existent element, is today fully falsified, and preemptively so. Capitalism has reached down to the essence of things, for that very reason metaphysically postulated, in order to have an allegedly central, dominant position to occupy. Metaphysics imposes to the territories of reality a military map. Metaphysics is a strategic plan for conquering the world. There is nothing left for us to manufacture our being artificially. The media no longer represent reality. Take a paper. What kind of paper? Which paper exactly? To cut out what words? The words of newspapers, the words coming out of newspapers, out of the media, are growing less and increasingly prefabricated.
Still, literature and the art of being continue in unaltered, Dadaist fashion. What if, ethically advised, truly important, supremely Spinozian, is precisely the painstaking diligence, the amount of labor, the earnestness and abnegation, the pleasure we have to invest in the dedicated, impersonal construction of our personal being, even though it has become increasingly fake and artificial, the artifice and the prefabricated having conquered the realm of reality in its entirety. The ardor and earnestness of producing something out of substantialized nothing is what really matters. The ontological act of manufacturing, joining together the individual being out of a social material. Ethically, we have to work on ourselves in order to be satisfied with ourselves. And this takes practice, technical skills, and a steady hand. It is the only satisfaction available to us. And this precisely is ethics. The pleasure, the bodily bliss of self-producing, of constituting ourselves even out of nothing, inevitably out of nothing, out of the fake, out of the artificial, out of the others, nevertheless, by your own self. As current theoreticians of democracy would say, when speaking of the election moment to which the essence of democracy has been reduced, art is exactly a procedure for producing the substance. It is only procedurally, technically, that substance is produced alongside joint social existence and a common world. Democracy is actually the trick for technically producing the common substance.
Democratically and artistically, supremely dadaistic therefore, the only problem is choice and pre-choice. We can resort to the randomness of picking things out of a sack or out of a bowl, of casting lots, yet it is not the choice, the matter of choosing representatives, be they words or members of parliament, politician, that counts, but what they do afterwards, in between two electoral moments, chance or no chance, which always supposes, socially at least, a pre-selection, a certain candidate and a certain election campaign, the Dadaist instance of choosing words out of a newspaper included. The possibility of choice is anyway rigged, and even if we destroy horizontally by shaking gently the syntax, the grammar of human and lexical democracy, semantics has already solved everything vertically by taking root in the choices already made.
We can only create ourselves in the loose fashion by deduction, extrication, and recombination in the exact order of chance. With infinite sobriety from the pre-existing substance, ethics being the one dictated by the imperative of painstakingly producing the self. Ontologically, we only exist out of the common substance of the others. It is nevertheless ethical to produce ourselves technically, procedurally, artistically, democratically, from the common substance.
Democracy is a simultaneous Dada poem, a Spinozian modulation of the common substance, divine due to its common nature. Divinity is the community of modulable substance, the art of democracy. Democracy is art, art itself today in lieu of politics, with a view to extending democracy, a procedural technique for regaining, producing, modulating the divine common substance. Per causam suim, teligo it cuius essentia involvit existentiam, sive it cuius natura non protest concipinisi existens.
By cause of itself, I mean that of which its essence involves existence, or that of which its nature cannot be conceived except as existing.
Essence only exists in manifested form, that is a manifestation and manifesto, potentia created by the act.
Per substantium intelligo it vot in se estes per se concipitur.
By substance, I mean that which exists in itself and is conceived through itself.
Per attributum intellige it vot intellectus de substantia percipit sacram ejunte essentiam constituens.
By attribute, I mean that in a substance which the understanding perceives as constituting the essence of the substance.
Per modum intelligo substantia affectionus inițiativei, pot in iOS, Bagvar etiam concilidur.
By mode, I mean the affections of a substance, or that which exists in something else, and through which it is also conceived.
Per duum intelligo ems absolute infinitum hoc ex substantiam constantem infinitis attributis volum, unam vompe aeternam et infinitam essentiam exprimit.
By God, I mean absolutely infinite being. That is, a substance consisting of infinite attributes, of which each expresses eternal and infinite essence.
It is the beginning, the Dada Zero movement, of Spinoza's ethics. Zara reiterit Spinoza, the activating randomness is chance, by the democratic descent in the randomness of tempestuously timeless democracy. Democracy is the art of producing ourselves out of the nothing, or the artifact, the technically artistically saturated abyss of a divine common substance.
Democracy is Dada, an act of constantly triggering off the creativity of randomness, the merging of data. Or else it's a crisis. The truly ecumenical miracle of Christ is regaining humanity regardless of the combination we resort to. No matter what combination of the data of humanity occur in, it is the Son of Man that emerges unfailingly. It is Jesus as the symbol of man that we rediscover time and time again, though each time as new man. Today's church, nonetheless, is the market, and it dramatically curtails all possible combinations, thus cutting and reassembling humanity's divine body.
Democracy is the art of modulating substance, even if in capitalist substance has been rendered completely artificial, completely undermined. The art of democracy consists in the technical and procedural recreation of infinite modulation, the infinitely modulable common substance. God is that, but divinity can be recreated, democratically artistic modulation of a divine substance. In other words, through creating the common as substance, through modulation, the attribute, the common, generates substance.
What else could art be if not the technical production of common substance?
Divinity is not given. It does not exist originally, but it can, should be created, produced through the art of democracy. Man's ethic duty is to create technically, procedurally, democracy, that is commonly modulable divine substance.
In Dadaist fashion, in Athenian democracy, preference was given to practical choice. Out of the whole of the community substance, of the political representatives, first of all the magistrates, by casting lots. Yet it does not matter how we select. Although the current liberal representative democracy has restricted itself to electoral arithmetics, democracy is, or can be, an integer, infinitesimal calculus, rather than simple arithmetic addition. As recently demonstrated, starting from a cryptic passage in Rousseau's Social Contract, by the most promising, if not the only, Romanian political philosopher, Radu Dobrescu, in his doctoral thesis, Arithmetical Democracy, Algebraic Democracy, Rousseau, General Will and the Small Differences, Laval University. The substantialization procedure of the common does not matter, nor does the democratic art of achieving the common, in other words, Spinoza's God, that is, substance through modulation. Artistic democratic modulation produces the common substance, this exactly being democratic ethics.
The Dadaist activation of chance is more democratic. By resorting to chance, we truly choose out of the common, divine substance of the world. Let us then cast our elected in a hat and extract them by turns, carefully, as if they were our own words, each and every one, for that's what they actually are. Let us cut them out of the common substance and shake gently, not by means of revolution, but constantly, the hatful of the elected, the canopia of democracy. Zara is Spinoza, is Athens. Democracy is Dada, or perpetual crisis.
Through Dada democracy, each vote will be positive. Da, da. A double affirmative in Russian and Romanian is also Dada, as Tsara says. In the Dada democracy, each vote is positive, double affirmative, since it does not matter who wins, who is elected, as the election was governed by chance through randomness in the process of picking out of the seminal bag of common humanity. The only thing that matters ethically is the way the elected ones are going to modulate over the future, by individual ethic productivity, the divine common substance of democracy. Subjected to the procedure without a candidature, populism and sophistic manipulation of chance, of the Dada democratic casting of lots, each of the elected will no longer feel themselves elected, but only a modulation of the common substance, having to produce themselves democratically, that is, technically, procedurally, and substantially, in ethical manner.
Dada, you know, that's our friend's democracy. Dada. Democracy is a permanent candle. Simultaneous poem in several languages, the same poem in different languages. Zara. What really matters is to have as much as you can in the hand, each and every one, and mix well, shaking gently. It's democratic shaking that ensures a re-substantializing democratic randomness.
Shake democracy. It is actually the large number that increases the chances of truth, fulfilling chance. Democracy is Dada, or perpetual crisis.
Infinite of democracy, the infinity of democratic substance, actualized or not, constantly virtual. Substance can only be democratic. The substance of democracy can only be produced democratically, that is, ethically.
Do manifest Dada. Da, 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 the common substance. It can only exist through manifestation.
And if various internationals of avant-garde movements exist, Dada can only be intemporal, can only constitute an intemporal. Dada is the absolute procedure. The phrase belongs to Tony Negri in the book on constituent power or infinite democracy in time, in space, and in substance.
Dada is the minus moment of art, of democracy as art, the circumvented gap, the dark of the seminal sack of chance out of which the substance of democracy continually issues.
Dada blockbox democracy, input-output legitimacy, Robert Goodin. Reflective Democracy, New York, Oxford University Press, 2003.
Certain instances which were not elected can be recognized as legitimate if they contribute to the production of what is recognized as socially useful.
Pierre Rodin Vallon, la légitimité démocratique, impartialité, réflexivité, proximité. Seuil 2008.
Today, art takes over in an attempt to recreate it, the expressivity of men's constituent power, which has been depoliticized, neutralized, deflected. Art invents constitutional spaces. Contemporary art is not political. There is no such thing as political art, as it has been fantasized about, rather than practiced at a certain point, is a misunderstanding, an error in phrasing. Art is politics. Is instead of politics. Contemporary art expresses, picks up and remakes the constituent power of the masses currently blocked and economically instrumentalized.
Art frees the space of productive relationship from the political. Art re-becomes medial. Contemporary art is a creation of alternative media, both expressive and communicative, of the human, of the constituent power of man, whose access to the democratic reinvention of the political has, once again, been blocked, being used and commandeered only for the economic production meant for consumption. Contemporary art reconstructs man's political expressivity in lieu of the political, hence its civic dimension, and particularly its fundamental medial humanism.
Art frees men's access ways to his own constituent expressivity, reinventing the denied political. In its fundamental mediality, contemporary art is not political, but the political itself in view of the political. He knows how the only expressive democracy against the increasingly aesthetic and cultural capitalism. And this at a decisive moment, such as the present one, when particularly in its marginal so-called emergent areas, China, India, Brazil, etc., capitalism takes advantage of the West's capitulation in order to score points in the historic struggle for dissociation from democracy.
In lieu of the political, contemporary medial art reconstitutes areas of expression for the infinitely vestigial constituent power of the human. It removes the capitalist cholesterol pretending to engulf democracy, so that the interior/exterior blood of life can start running again through the body of humanity.
Through the new self-reinvention of art as men's art medium, we once again become to ourselves beloved ghosts, Hamlet, friendly, render, positive. If we are to live transparently, let us make friends with ourselves once again, through the art that free, spatially, literally liberating, as the constituent ghosts of the ghost political.
What is seen through us? In the absence of art, nothing. Feature report on the mattresses of the future.
Late one night, I watch on TV a feature report on mattresses. This only apparently minor domain, but so close, so immediate, and so familiar to us that we do not see it or feel it, of which we must not precisely be aware, since it is the proper support of our dreams. That is ongoing and extraordinarily intense research, too. There have been revolutions in the unknown domain, from below us, of mattresses.
I went to bed warmed up by this insight into the far future, impressed by a slight nostalgia. My descendants, the men of the future, will sleep 1,000 times better, more qualitatively than I do. They will sleep extraordinarily. They will feel nothing more.
Or not, actually. They will feel extraordinarily good. They will prominently, positively feel the good, as De Quincey was saying about Kant when describing precisely his sleeping technique, his art of sleeping like a baby, after further self-involvement and the fact that he was really enjoying, as only a great philosopher, prophet of the faith of the whole humanity, could, a perceptible feeling of health, not as absence of ill health, of suffering, but as marked presence of non-suffering. The future will be philosophical.
My descendants will sleep 1,000 times better than I do, will live the good, while I just sleep equally well, but feel nothing more.
What a wonder, the positive death, transform it into a state of well-being, banally inserted into a life as supreme present. In that, in the future to come, it will be possible both that the good, the supreme, so abstract, so impersonal good, so impersonal good will be immediately and presently. Pleasantness will finally go down to history as a complete, immediate, palpable materialization of the good. The pleasantness. The future of humanity will be pleasant. It will be pleasantness itself. I so much envy the man of this wonderful future.
And all this thanks to the banal, humble mattresses, to the furious, truly philosophical as well, research in the field of mattresses. This is the true work of service to humanity.
Mattresses of the future will be a lot softer. Like close and intimate living beings, they will take the shape of our bodies. They will nestle us without deforming themselves. They will be moral objects.
We will feel nothing more. No opposition. All will curve disappearing around us, inciting us to dream. Life will finally be non-baroque, shadowless, contortionless dream. We will live exclusively to dream, and to directly and immediately realize our dreams. There will be no more television sets, no displays. We will see nothing more, as we do, or used to, until now. Dually, facetly, separately, trapped in the exterior, condemned to exteriority, caught in the rupture. We will be living, dreaming everything, every time, as in dream, with images of ourselves, as world of ourselves. The image itself will disappear to permanently become reality, an ephemeral reality, precisely because nothing should last any more as until now, since the very duration of things is the terror of history and fatality. All must be continually improved, all must become any time better, from one second to the other. We live in order to effectively realize progress, the permanent better, the infinite pleasance.
And all this, thanks to the mattresses of the future. No opposition, no salvation. All will be soft and befitting, passive, automatically yielding to us. All will embrace us, welcome us, with universal hospitality. Another philosophical dream which will finally come true. Nothing will any longer resist us. We will have swept any opposition by then. All will disappear. Immediate power, presence, foundationless, sensation of good, for the sensation of well-being is created precisely by the disappearance of reality.
We will evolve within a concentric void whose warm center of irradiation we will be. We will keep ourselves warm through a refracting but unrefractory world. On our side, all around us, a welcoming void will spread out. The environment itself will disappear.
Ah, the engineering of disappearance.
And then, only art will keep making something appear, will make us feel something.
Art will have to recreate unity, ruggedness, opposition, hardness, the encounter, the contact, the presence, and co-presence.
The true revolution in the invisible revolution of materials, the fabrication of matter itself. Today, the image teletechnology around us represent only the spadework of this evolution. While nowadays television sets, the screens, the technological infrastructure follow the way and the destiny of the image by virtualizing themselves and flattening, disappearing to realize themselves, similarly, reality itself, matter itself, will follow this destiny.
Whether live in cotton wool, live into softness, into the world.
Another current sign, the dominating relaxation desire of young people who lay down, even if it is only for 5 minutes, wherever they might find themselves while assuming the current postures of everyday life, they want to feel pleasant, to feel the pleasure of simply being, the realization of dream.
No resistance, infinitely.
And then, only art will still be able to restore the resemblance of reality, the remembrance of reality. Mere reality, time-worn, outdated reality, already pertains to the task of art.
The future role of the art will be enormous, monstrous. Art will have to recreate not only a world, but reality itself. Art will shoulder everything.
In the future, art will completely replace reality. It will have to substitute it as total ontological prothesis, so as to recreate the sensation of reality, the historical, historicized, outmoded displeasure of being through the other, with, on, and against the other. Art will be the counter-technique of the unpleasantness, of the resistance of materials. Only art will still be able to create the unpleasant sensation of history, tardiness, postponement, closure, non-fulfillment, helplessness, finitude, non-realization of the dream, at a time when engineering will have gone beyond the bounds of all these, and when the human itself will have become the supreme mattress of man. The mattress man.
Unfortunately, future belongs to art. We are condemned to become all artists if we want to keep sensing, to keep feeling something, whatever.
Hyper-revolution. Towards another pragmatism, life with art.
Out of our depth, played at our own game. This is not evolution, nor is it revolution. It is hyper-revolution. We become, give ourselves new bodies, we know that. No one has thus far determined what the body can do, become another. Hasty, accelerated evolution, impatient rush ahead toward the great solution. We cannot any longer tolerate darkness, imperfection, the comparison with a disseminated superhuman, with your ubiquitous ways, instruments of self-realization as superhumans available to us. So we step on it.
Man must be allowed to permanently lag behind, to be late, resisting in anachrony to himself, as he really is. This will push him to run, gasping for breath, striving to catch up with the automized progress. The progress itself is distinct parallel history, which finally emancipated from man after man had anticipated, had emancipated, for a moment, from the terror of history, Eliade, teasingly outruns man every day. Bearing in his soul the guilt and loss of the great opportunity, forever tortured, obsessed, unsatisfied, uptight, man is forced to evolve, to fill his life with a despair of running, to make up for progress.
The horizon of unseen, but immediately tangible chances and possibilities of self-realization, which he or she can no longer see, which are permanently escaping man and which keep him feeling enclosed. Progress does not any longer bring up the rear, nor does it ride the full horse. We live in a world environment more realized than we are. We theorize being in an imminently, not transcendently superior world, the more tangible, immediate, the more tormenting. A world which easily outruns us, which seems to self-produce and reproduce all alone, without us, but for us, in an environment of good realized outside of us and all around us, where climbing up or remembering is no longer necessary. We just have to adopt it, to use it, to make it forever peaceful, fragmentary, imperfectly our own. Accessories of superhumanity, the superhuman in accessories. Accessory man.
After modernity, we escaped by being played at our own game, saved by a fortunate anachrony to the political-industrial self. It is only for a historical second that the feeling of relief lasted. And now we're goaded again, but not macro-historically and politically, but micro-historically and economically and technologically. Every day, moment by moment, pastorally economically goaded by envy. The political has stepped aside. With our transition from communism to capitalism, the countries, the peoples, the societies, the states, the men in Eastern Europe, we did not hit upon an established, self-confident capitalism at the stage of pure functioning, or that of internal revolution, of resetting. But we stepped into a macro transition of capitalism itself, into a capitalism at the same time exacerbated and diluted, victim of its own substantial, hyperbolized tendencies which have become irrepressible, into an unhinged capitalism which has simultaneously irreclaimably fallen under itself, thus functioning through emphasis, through a perpetual state of exception.
This brings forth the fear and haste to give name to, proclaim that globalization, purely performative gesture, classic disguise of performativeness under the certifiableness, descriptiveness, self-hypnosis.
This does not involve reality, but a way of reading, a reading grid, a way of interpreting through naming.
When the referent is missing or is chaotic, that would be all, so even more when the substance crisis is now hyperbolized by our postmodern, post-traumatic state. The fear of a nameless pushes us toward relievingly consensual incantations, making us whisper one another on all the channels, often all the time. We have world, the world exists, globalization, mondialization, globalization, mondialization. They are certain, it is for sure.
Media news are at every moment the enunciation. We have name, we live, are an epoch.
Habemus papa, habemus nomen.
Even smaller actants, always individual and even under-individualized, infra-individualized mockery. Even smaller actants, always individual and even under-individualized, infra-individualized, micro-individualized actants. Man decomposed into minimal traits, into desires and interests, after having reformulated and eliminated desires as irrational, interests are incited to change into market desires, cravings. Submerged into a world of good, a global market.
The Anglo-Saxon philosophical ideology of methodological individualism and neoclassical economics is based on the uncrossable chart abyss between the individualities reduced to themselves, kept between their own limits, acting directly on the market notion.
The intermediary levels, or otherwise put, the traditional controlling and standardizing identities, such as the peoples, the nations, or the parties, are replaced. They are reformulated. The old ones have played their modernizing role. It is all over. Now we must micro-collectively be something else. Sexes, ethnic groups, organizations, associations, consumers of goods, not only of goods. The good offered cannot be but consumed. The vital existential relation with good and truth cannot be other than that of consumption, which is barely sensibly related to the full-bodied Eucharist.
We do not have access to the production of good as a world market. We do not feel that we participate to it other than intensively, immediately, collectively. Technology, the world technology produces them, self-reproduces automatically. There is no mass self-individualization other than by the consumption of goods. Production of gold is monthly, immediately, contagiously inaccessible. No one can appropriate it individually. It does not offer itself except to consumption. It can be only consumed, believed, and embodied through consumption in good state. Essentially, consumption must be somatized, which means that by the instrumentality of consumption, we offer ourselves the only chance of self-realization through the making of new bodies.
Market metempsomatosis. Every day a new body. From one body to another, following the track of accessories.
Blackmail man.
After the period of the so-called Cold War and the politics of the so-called nuclear deterrence, the world has become an objective situation of blackmail. Today we're oppressed twice, blackmailed twice, with our past, the sins and the disasters of modernity, and with a bright future of realization through consumption. The objective blackmail is often imperceptible, since it is interiorized.
Production Consumption, second essay on waste.
Modernity could not have succeeded otherwise. In fact, it produces directly residues, directly residual. Modernity produces by throwing away, by eliminating. It produces to be thrown away. Supine, suspire, signal word, simple to use instructions, user's guide.
Modernity produces residuals. Products of modernity are downright already consumed. Trash. Consumption is anticipated as more. There cannot be on the market other goods than those already consumed, which indicates that and how they should be. Since production consumes, modern capitalist production is by itself primordially consumption of the old, of the already existing, even before being. In order to be able to be production of the new, it catalyst, we consume the waste of the world, residues of existence, we make a feast of trash.
Consumer concentration society.
Comparison between the concentration camps, gulag, and hypermarkets, understood as organized types of industrialized space. The promiscuity man commodities in distinction.
We are not goaded, taken, deported. We are deporting ourselves. The decision is already taken, given the concentrationist organization of space. Let's buy everything, or at least most of it. Blockage, drowning, suffocation of choice, and of the life shopping program. The commodities call each other at no distance, or huddle together, piled up and aggregated without distance, without passages, merged, hyper-identified, being all the same, in fact only one. Consumer good, good through consumption. Consumption the only way to good. Capitalism.
Plus discernment. 0/1. All or nothing.
Moral digitalization.
Again, a die without transition, directly from communism and post-communism, as false interlude, as false purgatory. The purgatory is the tax haven into globalization. Only transition to democracy, which is the condition of capitalism, although it is permanently and necessarily violated by the latter.
We step not on firm, stable soil, as we are asked to, as we are invited to think, without trouble, but in the midst of a macro-transition of capitalism itself.
The former political accounts, the informal economical, seriously affecting the social moral.
Emphasis was placed exclusively on our possible unreadiness for democracy, but no one in the world can be fully prepared for democracy. However, there was no emphasis at all on our unreadiness for capitalism.
The old and the new poor of the world save capitalism once more.
A more important historical mission than the presumed and false mission of the proletariat. We have been flattered, buttered, historically divinized as the proletariat, the producers of history.
Now no one flatters us anymore, but it's only now we are the true heroes.
Consumption heroes. Heroes through consumption.
It is not man the producer who saves history. It is man the consumer who saves capitalism.
The fate of capitalism is decided in Eastern Europe and in general in the marginal regions. We have been integrated, but as marginals, precisely so as to save capitalism.
Not in order to produce, but in order to consume. Since we have not lived or made the historic capitalism, we are unready for consumption. We re-establish, in fact, the new definition of capitalism as production of not only for consumption. We consume by expelling, by unveiling the essence of production as primordial consumption, as production of dejection.
We are the saviors of capitalism. Poverty saves Romania. Underdevelopment integrates Romania.
Indeed, the essential integrated marginal region, visibility, the perceptibility of the phenomenon, and of the process which saved capitalism through consumption, according to the illusion that history could be saved through production, through action, is indirectly proportional to their acuity. The more acute, the more invisible they are, in the West due to continuity.